Praise God. We will be in the book of Matthew this morning. Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. Amen. And we're going to read just one main verse. And then we're going to get started. Praise God. Matthew chapter 3 verses 10 through 12. All right, y'all ready? Y'all got the scriptures?
No, hang on.
Okay. Sandy got it up on the screen, but that's okay. I like people that still flip late pages, amen? Matthew chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. We kind of mentioned this in our text last week, but this is John the Baptist speaking when he was preaching in the wilderness, preparing the way of the Lord and the arrival of Jesus that had been prophesied for thousands of years and finally came to pass. John the Baptist says, "And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which bringeth forth not good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner." That's another word for barn or storehouse. "But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." We talked last week about, once again, John the Baptist and how he was the forerunner to the Messiah. And we've spoken multiple times and said that the word Messiah means anointed one. It's the Hebrew version of the word Christ, which means anointed one. Jesus was the one that God had been promising for thousands of years. Amen. And it was also prophesied and foretold in advance that there would be a prophet like Elijah that would come before Jesus and he would prepare the way for the Lord. And that's what John the Baptist is doing. And as a matter of fact, in this passage of scripture, if you back up, the reason that he's talking about this tree being cut down is because, you remember, the Pharisees, the religious leaders of the time, showed up. You know, there's a lot of times, and I'll probably end up saying it before this morning's over, where people think that they're okay because they're caught up in religion or they do some form of religion, and in their minds they think that they're all right. That's what these Pharisees were about. They just knew that they were okay, and they showed up in the wilderness where John the Baptist was preaching, and they were wanting to check out what he was doing. And basically what he told them was this. He called them a brood of vipers. He said, "You brood of vipers, who told you to come out here?" He said, "You need to bring forth meat to repentance." In other words, you need to show forth fruit that you've truly repented and given your heart to the way that God's going. Because you understand, religion does not want to submit itself or bow its knee to God's true way. Religion wants to puff itself up. Religion wants to do its own thing. It wants to get its own acknowledgement. It doesn't want to bow its knee to the lowly Savior. God's doing something upon this earth that is completely contrary to the way that men's minds and hearts work. And so what he was saying to the religious leaders is, "And don't say that you're children of Abraham." God is laying the axe to the tree. He's going to cut down every tree that doesn't bear fruit. And in a sip, that's not really what I'm wanting to preach tonight, this morning, I'm sorry. I'm wanting to preach the second part of the verse. But, you know, what I want you to understand is that in the Old Testament, many times the Hebrew way of writing and communicating the scriptures, oftentimes they would communicate in something called a couplet. They would say the same thing twice in two different ways. In the first thing, what he was saying is that the tree that doesn't bear fruit is going to be cut down. In the second verse, he's talking about the difference between wheat and chaff. He's talking about the difference between wheat and chaff and how the chaff's going to be burned up, but the wheat is going to be harvested. Now, what I want you to know is that this passage of scripture, it focuses on both judgment and a concept called separation. Much of what I'm wanting to preach to you this morning is definitely centered around the idea of separation. The Lord just put in my heart a specific word, threshing floor. And this is how this message came about. All of this judgment and this separation that's taking place in this little passage of scripture that we just read is taking place in a specific location. And if your eyes aren't tuned to it or your ears aren't tuned to it, you may very well miss it. But I got to tell you that there's two words that give it away. The fan and the floor. The fan and the floor in that passage of Scripture give away where this is all taking place, and it's taking place on a threshing floor. Now, what was a threshing floor? In ancient days, they were agrarian cultures, right? In other words, you couldn't just go down to Walmart Marketplace and get your food. They had to grow food. They had to sow seed. They had to tend and cultivate the crops. And then there was a time for harvest. And when harvest time came, it was a joyous festival time, but they needed a specific location. It was called a threshing floor. A threshing floor, basically, simply stated, it was just an open space that oftentimes had been trampled down ahead of time by animals. Any trees would have been cleared out, the ground or any grass would have been trampled. It's just a flat, open surface that was prepared. And what they would do is that they would go out into the harvest and they would take the sheaves, another word for bundles, and they would bring it all to the threshing floor. So, you know, whenever we studied the book of Ruth, and we're going to mention Ruth this morning, the whole scenario of the book of Ruth is taking place during harvest time. And what they're doing is they're getting sheaves. And they'd go out there and they'd grab a handful of sheaves, they'd have one of those sickles, and they'd cut it at the bottom, and then I don't know if they would tie it or they would just throw it down like that, and then they would, at one point in time, they would load them all up, and they would take those sheaves and they'd put them on the threshing floor. Then they'd have oxen with sleds behind them, and they would run those oxen with those sleds on top over and over again on top of all of that wheat. And what would happen is that the grain would be separated from the stalk, and ultimately the stalk and the chaff would be pulverized. And now you're left with a pile of a mixture of things that's taking place. And I got to tell you something, that there's a mixture on this world. There's a mixture of godliness and ungodliness. There's a mixture of sin and holiness. There's a mixture of truth and lies. And there's a mixture of unbelievers and believers. And not only is there a mixture upon the earth of those that believe and those that don't believe, but there's a mixture in your heart. The truth of the matter is that our first birth in Adam caused us to have something called a sinful nature, where we receive from our father Adam that which is ungodly. But the good news is that if you're born again, amen, that the old man of Adam has died with Christ, he's been buried with him, and a new man has been resurrected to newness of life. And in, hallelujah, in Peter's epistle, he said that we now have become partakers of the divine nature. That doesn't mean that you never mess up again. What it does mean, though, is according to Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, that oftentimes there's a war that's taking place inside your individual person.
Amen.
Not only is there a war on this earth of good versus evil, of believers, non-believers, the enemy and our God, but there's also a war oftentimes raging in the internal nature of the believer, and there's a battle between his flesh and the Spirit of God. Because the Spirit of God is telling him to go one way, and his flesh is saying, I don't want to go that way. I want to go the way that I want to go. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Amen. And so, but what I need you to know is that now we have this mixture on the threshing floor. It's a mixture of chaff and wheat. Well, the Scripture says that we read that the chaff is of no use. It must be burned. And what they would do then is that it says right here, if you look back at the Scripture we read, it says, can you go to the next verse? I didn't even put it in my notes. Matthew chapter 3, I guess verse 13. That was
13? Mm-hmm.
Okay. 12. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, you want verse 12. That's good. I couldn't see it. Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor. Now, that word fan, to be honest with you, in the King James, it's an outdated word, and it's really probably not the right interpretation. And what I mean by that is, it's not a fan it's talking about. It's talking about a fork. They didn't have electric fans back then, and they didn't have fans that were mechanically able to actually blow chaff away anyway. It's talking about a winnowing fork, kind of something like a pitchfork would be. And essentially what they would do is they would take this fork and they would walk up to this mixture of this pile that's there, and this is just where the work starts. And essentially he's saying Jesus has a fork in his hand. He's got a winnowing fan in his hand. And he's going to thoroughly purge his floor. He's going to purge. He's going to get rid of the chaff that's on the threshing floor. See, we're talking about a harvest now. We're not talking about a literal harvest. We're talking about a spiritual harvest. God is about his business upon this earth. And I know I've spoken it to you many times, but you got to believe me when I tell you, God is preparing a harvest from this earth. And he's got the fan in his hand. He's got the fork in his hand. And he reaches underneath and he grabs a hold of a pile of that mixture. And he flings it in the air. And when he does, the chaff, it doesn't have any substance to it. It's real light and flimsy. And the wind takes it away. And maybe it's piled up in another location where later it's thrown into the fire. But yet the grain is heavier. It has substance and it falls back to the ground. And ultimately it is stored in the garner, the barn, the storehouse for the time frame when it would either be utilized for food or it would be sold for profit, whatever the case. This is an imagery, an illustration of the end of the age. This is an illustration of where God is trying to let us know that this upon this earth there's a mixture. Amen. There's a mixture of those that don't believe and those that will believe. And there's going to come a place where there's going to be a separation. There's going to be a separating out that's going to take place. Now, I got to tell you, there's another passage of scripture that I wanted to get you to turn to. And before we turn there, I want you to know that's basically the title of my message this morning. And for the next however long, that's what I want to minister to you. The title of the message is There's a Harvest on the Threshing Floor. Amen. And in Matthew chapter 13, this is the other passage I wanted you to see. Matthew 13, verses 24 and 25. It's another parable. Now, I've taught this before in the past, but I will just go ahead and explain it again. Sometimes it breaks up the flow when you stop and teach, but it's not really about trying to impress people. It's about trying to make sure we understand stuff. And the word parable comes from this Greek word, parabolo. And this is a Greek word that's a preposition that means side. Does that make sense? Side. And this is, what does that look like right there? If you take that O off, it's a ball. It's actually where we get our word. It means to throw. All right? And so a parable is when you throw two things alongside one another for comparison and contrast. All right? And so whenever Jesus speaks forth another parable, he's speaking forth the parable about the kingdom. He's using an illustration to show us what the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God is looking like. Now, unfortunately, when we hear the words kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God, we think of something far away in the sky. The reality of it is that God's doing his work on earth. Amen. That's why Jesus said, when you pray, pray this way: Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your name is separate. Your name is holy. There is no other name above your name. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. See, God's will is done in heaven. And when people try to rebel in heaven, they get cast down to the earth. Like Jesus said, I saw Satan fall like lightning to the earth. Amen. But God is moving upon the inhabitants of the face of the earth. He will rule and reign again upon this earth. Amen. In the millennial reign of Christ. And we already know that. But in the meantime, God is moving and he's operating and he's causing a separation to take place where he's revealing his truth and he's using this parable to describe to us what the world looks like today. He says another parable in Matthew 13, verses 24 through 25, put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. Matthew 24, verses 13 and verse, I'm sorry, chapter 13, verse 26. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? And he said unto them, an enemy has done this. The servant said unto him, wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? In other words, should we go pull the tares up? He said, no. Lest while you gather up the tares, you root up also the wheat with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. And so what we see here is now another picture. So the field is the earth. The sower, the good man, the sower is the Lord. The seed is the eternal gospel. And God says, I sowed good seed in the ground. There was a spot in Isaiah, you see, God's always been about the same plan. You understand that? We've explained that in quite great detail. That the reason that God created a nation called Israel really was so that, number one, he could have an oracle. What does that mean? A mouthpiece to speak forth this truth, but also a womb. He allowed Messiah to be given birth through the nation of Israel, if you would permit me to say it that way. Does that make sense? He separated out himself a people. There was no nation called Israel. There was a bunch of pagan nations following after false gods. And God told Abraham, come out from amongst your father's house, and I will make you a great nation. And I will bless those who bless you, curse those who curse you, and through you, all nations of the earth shall be blessed. Paul got a revelation of that. I know I say it all the time, but just bear with me. Paul got a revelation of that in Galatians 3 and said that when he said seeds, meaning Abraham's offspring, he didn't say many as the whole nation. He said one seed, which was Christ. Paul got a revelation that God's whole purpose in the nation of Israel was to give us Jesus. Amen. So we see this world, and it's a heart, it's a field, and there's seed that's been sown. God's been sowing seed, and he's been telling people about his plan through the ages. He used Israel to explain. He's coming, Messiah's coming, and he explained in Isaiah in Psalm chapter 22 that he would be crucified for us, that he would pay the penalty of our sin, and he explained way back in the garden that it would be through his work that the serpent's head would be crushed, that his power would be destroyed. And so God hasn't just all of a sudden decided to send us Jesus. No, he told us the whole time that he was coming. So here we have this earth and the good seed has been sown, but all of a sudden when the men slept, an enemy came and he sowed tares. Now the interesting thing about a tare is that from a distance it looks just like a piece of wheat. Can't tell the difference from far. You got to get up close to it and inspect it. And when you get close to it, you realize it doesn't really have any fruit on it. And so the Lord said, you know, his disciples said, or the men said, shall we remove the tares? No, you just kind of let it go. You let it go until you get to the harvest. What I'm trying to tell you is that at the harvest, there's going to be a separation. And there's a lot of people that think today, and listen to me, I'm not talking about walking in perfection. None of us are perfect. We all fall short of the glory of God. Amen. What I'm talking about is a revelation that God has a plan. Yeah. And the plan required the giving of his son. I can't tell you how many people I talked to last night. And whenever I was talking to them, I'm like, hey, man, you know about the Lord? Yeah, I'm baptized. You know, and I'm baptized. Or, man, yeah, I go to church, dude. Yeah, I'm good. We good. You know, and it's kind of like, so sometimes I would just walk off, and then sometimes I couldn't help it. I'm like, hold on a second. Do you understand what it means to be born again? I said I'm baptized. But do you understand? So you believe, right? Yeah, I believe. I'm like, well, you know what, dude? I said, my sister told me this back in the day, back when I was getting high and drinking. And you know what? When she told me this, I wasn't too happy about it. But I'm about to tell you. And I hope that you don't get too upset. And the girl that's over there, she kind of laughed because, you know, she thought that was kind of funny. But I said, the book of James says, you believe there's one God, you do well. The devils also believe, yet they tremble. A devil, a demon spirit, has intellectual understanding that a man named Jesus was full of the kingdom of heaven, full of the kingdom of God, and full of the power of God because they ran into him on the streets of Galilee. And when he took authority over them, they fled and begged, please let us go at least into the herd of the swine. Please don't make us leave this region, because it was a stronghold that they had power over. And they didn't, but they understood that Jesus had power and authority that he exercised over them. It doesn't mean anything just because you believe intellectually, and that's where the majority of the world is. They think because their mama was a Christian, their daddy was a Christian, their grandma was a Christian, or that they were raised in some family where the Gallup poll says 85% of Americans are Christians, that they're believers. No! If that was the case, the whole world would be turned upside down for Jesus. Because the truth of the matter is this, is that when you believe from your heart, and this is what I told him last night. I can tell when I'm losing them, but I can't help myself. I got to tell them. When you believe from your heart, a miracle happens according to Ephesians 1:13. You get sealed with the Spirit of promise. What does that even mean, man? I'm going to tell you what it means. The Holy Spirit moves into your heart, and when He moves in, He don't leave nothing the same way that it was. He starts dealing with you. He starts messing with you. He starts speaking to you. He starts showing you things in your life that He wants to be changed. And each and every one of us know that there's been many times that the Lord's dealing with us. Yes. He's contending with us. He probably doesn't talk a whole lot like Matt does. Sometimes he might, but really, for most part, he usually just kind of whispers. And he says, he speaks softly. And he says, I want you to do something about that. Amen. And sometimes we listen, and sometimes we just hold off. But I'm letting you to know that not only is there a separation taking place on this earth, there's a separation taking place in our hearts and the hearts of the believers, where the Holy Spirit lives in there. He's dealing with us. Amen. Yes. He's dealing with us a little bit at a time. And I'm going to be honest with you. A lot of times Christians don't like to hear that kind of message any more than that old boy at the Shrimp and Petroleum Festival liked to hear. And I could tell he didn't like to hear it because he wouldn't even look at me in the eyes. He was like, dude, I just wish you would move on with your life and let me move on with my life because I'm ready to go get another one. And I understand that, but guess what? You know what that is? That may be because the preacher is, and it might be because the preacher's a bonehead. It might be. You might just not like him because you don't like his personality, but more than likely, that's not what it is. And more than likely, it's the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Can you put up there John chapter 16? Because as a matter of fact, I wanted to look at John 16 because I wanted to make a point that whenever we're talking about wheat and chaff, and we're talking about the separation of sin and from holiness and truth from lies, that once again, we're not only talking about the individual life being changed, because guess what? God wants to remove chaff that's in your life. There's chaff in your life. And the work of the Spirit is going to be the grain, and the chaff is the stuff of your flesh that God's wanting to get rid of. But guess what? Chaff can also be representative of tares. A tare versus a wheat. And the tares and the chaff represent those that are unbelievers that refuse to believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in the end, they are going to be burned with unquenchable fire. Man, that's a hard message to receive. I didn't write it. God wrote it. And He sent His Son to die on a cross so that you didn't have to die and go to a devil's hell. God's a good God. And He loves you. And He sent an eternal lamb to die in your place. Amen. He don't want you to go to hell. Go. I made a way. I made a bridge for you to be able to cross over, but you don't want to take my path.
Yeah.
You don't want to go on the journey that I want to take. In John chapter 16, verses 7 through 8, it says right here, it says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send Him unto you. Now this is a part of a dialogue, a long dialogue that Jesus is having with His disciples. They realize now that He's leaving, He's going away, and they're upset. He's trying to explain to them, no, it's a good thing. See, in order for God's plan of salvation to move forward, this is part of it. Jesus said, I have to go to the cross. I have to go to the cross. I have to die for the sins of humanity. I'm going to resurrect from the dead because I have no sin. I'm going to pay the penalty of sin and the death, hell, and the grave will not be able to hold me down. I'm going to come busting out of this grave. I'm going to conquer death, hell, and the grave. Hallelujah. I'm going to ascend to my Father. And when I do, I'm going to send the other Comforter, the Holy Spirit, the one that's been called alongside to help. And when I send Him, He's not only going to help you, He's not only going to lead and guide you, but He's going to do some things for the world, whether they like it or not. Whether the world likes it or not, the Holy Spirit is going to do some things for them. Amen. And you know what He's going to do? This is what He's going to do. He's going to, when He comes, He's going to reprove the world of sin. What does that word reprove mean? Convince them. Convict them and convince them. He's going to take them to court. The Holy Spirit's taking the world to court. Now, they can act like the drama wasn't played out on the stage. They can try to change the channel all they want to if they don't want to listen to it. But the reality of it is that God, upon this human stage called Earth, allowed this narrative to be played forth. And the narrative that was played forth was that He sent the sinless one to die on the cross to pay the sins of humanity. And in front of everyone, everybody in all front of all those witnesses, he resurrected again from the dead. And John the Beloved said, we saw him. I saw him with my eyes. I heard him with my ears. My hands handled the word of life. Peter said we haven't followed cunningly devised fables, but we were with him on the mount. We saw him transfigured before our very eyes. We saw his raiment turn white as snow. We know he was the one from God. And they watched him. They watched his glorified body as he resurrected from the dead. And they talked to him. And they walked with him. And hundreds of others saw him also. So much so that the message still lives today. Somebody asked me last night, well, where is he? He's right here, man. He's living alive right here. And that's why I'm here. Why do you think that I came out here tonight? Do you think I got other things I could be doing? No. Somebody came to me and told me one time that Jesus loved me, that he died for me. And I woke up the next morning and I read that thing. And the Holy Spirit began to deal with my heart and began to reveal to me, you're not right, son. You think you're all right, but you're not okay. All this I did for thee is what it said on that piece of paper as the blood streamed down his face. He died for me. Yes. And now I received it by faith, and I'm far from perfect, but I'll never be the same because Jesus transformed my life, and I have to tell somebody about it because I believe he will. He's going to put him to court. He's going to reprove the world of sin. Why? Because how's he going to do it? Because he died for sin. This story's out, man. The secret is no longer a secret. The world knows there was a man named Jesus. He died on a cross. And the world has heard that he overcame death, hell, and the grave. And when you tell somebody that, come on.
Yes, amen.
When you tell them that, I'm telling you right now, the Holy Spirit begins to move upon their hearts. Oh, they can reject it. They can reject it all they want to. I was talking to one old boy. I know I don't want to get too caught up in some of these stories. I was talking to one old boy, and he's like, hey, he's very intellectual. I like talking to these people because I learn from them. I learn how to catch the next one the next time. He's like, I'm more of a deist. In other words, God is a big old God, but he's far beyond my comprehension, and this is just one little project that he has going on, and he could care less about us. And, you know, as I began to talk to him about various things and trying to open his mind to physical things that could be seen, he finally, like, started to listen, and I could tell that he was beginning to listen. And then at the same time, I could see his little brain and his mind computing that he was saying, but I'm not going to believe it. Even though some of what you make sense, he didn't come out and say this. He did say, oh, that makes a little bit of sense. Even though he didn't come out and say this, that's what his brain did for him. It computed to the point where he said, it makes some sense, but I'm choosing not to believe it. I'm not going to allow myself to believe it. Because for whatever reason, they come against and they refute and they push away what the Holy Spirit is trying to convince them of, trying to convict them of. It is going to convict the world of sin. It was displayed in front of human eyes that Jesus had to die. Amen. He's going to convince the world or reprove the world or convict the world of righteousness. Because the righteous one has come.
Yes. Amen.
He's going to convict the world of judgment because the prince of this earth has been judged.
Yes.
Jesus judged him in his works, and now all those that choose to follow after his ways are following after them. There's been a line drawn in the sand. God has made it real clear. That's why the gospel must be preached. Not some little feel-good message, some little tickle-your-ears message that fills all the seats up in the church and makes everybody feel good. Oh, look at this big old nice church we have and all these little wonderful ministries we have. And it's become such a wonderful social gathering. I'm not saying that it's a bad thing for Christians to fellowship. That's not what I'm talking about. There's a difference between a real gospel and a false gospel. There's a difference between trying to just make people feel good versus telling them the truth and that their souls can be made right with the God of heaven.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Praise God. And so there we were, and here we are with this, with the tares and the wheat and what's going on here. You know, even there's a spot in Isaiah, that's kind of where I went off, in the Old Testament, where God spoke to Isaiah in chapter 5. You don't have to really turn there, but in it he used the vineyard analogy. And what he talked about was, he said, what more could have I done for my vineyard? I built a fence around it. I put a choice vine in there. I built a watchtower. I built a wine press. In other words, he was prepared for a harvest. But instead, it grew wild grapes. Just as the evil one sowed tares, In the Old Testament, God prepared a people called Israel, but yet they turned against him. And they began to act like wild grapes instead of a cultivated vine. It wasn't the harvest that God was looking for. And you and I need to understand that there's a harvest on the threshing floor, and God is going to mix it up, and he's going to separate it, amen. And that's what he's doing upon this earth as the gospel is being preached. There's many things that are taking place in this parable of the tares and the wheat. Some of the things that just stick out in my mind is that we need to understand that God has a plan. He sowed good seed, but the enemy has a plan too. He came behind and he's sowing bad seed. You know, bad seed can represent so many things. It represents false religions of the world.
Yes.
People don't like to hear that. Oh, here you go, dude. You're separating. Yes, I am. I'm separating. I'm going to keep on separating. And I'm not doing it purposefully to get people mad, but if it gets people mad, then that's what's going to have to happen. There are lying religions out there. Do you understand?
Yes.
And I can't tell you how many people I talked to about this last night. Do you understand that the Bible says there's a fallen angel and his name is Satan? And do you understand that in Revelation 17 it talks about a harlot and she's false religion, but she's the mother of harlots? You know what a mother does? She gives birth. She's given birth to false religions upon the face of the earth. That means that you can't get there through Buddha. You can't get there. Don't make me get into all the philosophy of bringing you all the way back to the garden. We don't have time to get there. God has a word. He speaks to those to whom he chooses to speak. That's what Mr. Intellectual wanted to know in the park. And he said, but all of these other narrative stories, you may not have ever heard of this. The Epic of Gilgamesh, it was something that was found in cuneiform text in the Middle East. And it predates the Bible. So now what are you going to do? I said, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. God is the creator of this world. And God spoke to his people. He gave his oracle to Adam. And the story was passed through oral tradition until he created his people called Israel. And it was documented on paper. And it was the right story because it was God's story. And every other story has come from the liar, the fallen angel that has inspired men to come up with false religions, false ways, every way that you can ever imagine to turn people's hearts and minds away from. I know I turned 10 in Singapore. I saw all the Hindu gods. I saw the people worshiping Buddha. I've talked to Muslims, and many of them are kind, nice, gentle people. But the reality of it is that they've been deceived.
Yes.
They've been deceived by a liar. And then whenever the gospel goes forth and they reject it, because humanity wants to believe in a false law, a false love. A false sense of unity. They were, oh no, we all have to be unified. You're not going to be unified upon human behavior. You're not going to be unified as human beings. We have to be unified in God's plan. What God has done. God sent his son. And as we stay unified on that, but they're going to call you separatists. That's what the message is this morning.
Amen.
It's a message of separation.
Amen.
But it's not only just in false religions. The enemy, the liar, has also snuck into the church.
Yes.
And tares represent false doctrine. And they will lead people astray and produce something that is not true grain, true fruit, that cannot be harvested at the end. Now, I'm not the Holy Spirit. So I don't know who's really in the faith and who's not. And there's each and every one of us in this room that have believed false doctrine at some point in time in our lives.
Yes.
We just didn't know any better. But the reality of it is that as we seek God and ask him to speak truth to us, he will lead and guide us, amen, in all truth. I'm just here to tell you that there's a mixture upon this earth, and God's causing a separation to take place. So the enemy has a plan too. And I needed another thing in this parable. It tells us that evil and righteousness are coexisting. There's tares and there's wheat. And they continue to coexist together until the harvest takes place. But not only that, is it on the earth, once again, there's a dual nature on the inside of you. I want you to be reminded of that. Adamic nature, a Christ nature. A sinful nature, a divine nature. Now, that doesn't give you the permission to just do whatever you want.
Amen.
No, he's your Lord. He's your Savior. He's your Master. Each and every one of us, he's the King. We are to submit to him, bow knee to him, and give reverence to him. And say, God, I might be struggling in this area, but I believe that you are King, sovereign over my heart. I need you to give me victory in this area of my life. So not only do we see separation between believers and unbelievers, but we see the separation or removal of sin in the life of the believer. Amen. In a similar fashion to that process takes place on the threshing floor. This is really kind of my first point. In a similar fashion to the way that that separation of the grain and the stalk. Remember we talked about that? The ox and the sled going over and separating from the stalk and the grain. There's a crushing that's taking place in that moment in time. And then the next thing that you know, what happens is that the mixture's thrown up in the air and the wind takes the bad stuff away. Amen? And it's a similar concept or illustration that takes place for you spiritually. God allows the crushing to take place.
Yes.
The book of Hebrews chapter 12 says, don't despise the chastening of the Lord. Don't despise the chastening of the Lord. Don't grow weary whenever He rebukes you. Because God chastens those whom He loves.
Yes.
Like a father would correct his own child. You belong to God. God allows things to take place in your life to chasten you. What are you saying? That God caused my sister to die? That's not what I'm saying. God doesn't. The enemy is the one that's trying to cause evil to take place in your life. But does God allow it? Yes, He allows things to happen. How do you know that? The book of Job. God allows things to happen in the life of the believer, but it's for a bigger, greater purpose. He allows chastisement to take place. And ultimately, when that chastisement takes place, the Bible says in Hebrews 12 that we become partakers of the peaceable fruit of righteousness. He's working on stuff. See, just as that sled separates the grain from the chaff, those chastising trials and tribulations begin to reveal things that are on the inside of our hearts when we go through these pressure circumstances.
Yeah.
But when you're a child of God and you begin to ask God, why, Lord? Why is this going on in my life? He will show you. Let me tell you something. You can try to turn the page, but if you let Him, He'll pinpoint it right there.
Yes.
There it is, right there.
Yes.
You wanted to know? Bang! There it is, right there. And then, like only God could do, the sweet, check this out, pneuma. That's where we get our word pneumatics. What is anybody that knows anything about it, you know, mechanical stuff knows pneumatics has to do with air-driven mechanical things that are driven by air. The word pneuma, pneumonia, means air. This is the word in the Greek for the Holy Spirit. It means breath or wind. Just, I'm telling you, this is so beautiful. Just as the sled with the ox and the chastisement of the trial grind and separate and begin to reveal to you the things in your life that God doesn't want there, whenever you bring it to the Lord because your faith is in Christ and the Holy Spirit lives in you and He's dealing with you, and you give it to God and you say, Lord, I don't want this in my life. The sweet, gentle breath and wind of God, the pneuma of God, begins to blow that chaff away. He begins to remove it. The main point that I want to give you out of this is this. You can't just fix yourself up, and you can't just get free in your own strength from the strongholds that have plagued you. You need the wind of the Holy Spirit moving and operating in your life, doing the work for you that you can't do for yourself. You can go to all the self-help classes that you want to. I'm talking about spiritual strongholds. I'm not saying you ain't ever going to learn something somewhere, but spiritual strongholds will not be broken and removed through any kind of self-help class.
Amen.
It's only going to be freedom from the power of the Holy Spirit,
yeah.
And He will free you from those things
yes.
that have plagued Amen. You in the midst of your life. So that's really the first point I wanted to make is that I see this illustration in the life of the believer and how God desires to remove things in the midst of our life. You know, though, whenever we look at the Old Testament and even in the New Testament, we see the repeated theme of harvest. We've discussed that before. There's much agriculture, multiple stories of harvest. Because we see a repeated theme of harvest, and we also understand from the parables that God is going to harvest people from this earth. Amen. That's really the big theme. That's one of the big things of the themes of the Bible. But so if we would expect to see repeated themes of harvest throughout the scripture, we should also expect to see repeated places where threshing floors show up. So I want to just take a couple of stops before we close this morning at some places where some threshing floors took place. And I hope to be able to explain to you and show you that in the gospel that God's word is being communicated through these various threshing floor places. I just found, I think, three of them. And I'm not really going to as much turn to those passages as much as I'm going to try to tell you the stories. But if you like to take notes, I'm going to at least tell you where they are so you can write them down and you can go read them for yourself when you have time. The first place I want to stop is the book of Ruth.
Yes.
Just real quick, I just want to tell you, the book of Ruth is a beautiful picture. 1,200 years during the time frame of the Judges. 1,200 B.C. 1,200 years before Jesus would ever show up on the face of the earth. We have an awesome story in the book of Ruth. First, there's a famine. Right? This world is full of famine. Full of sin. Full of brokenness. But yet, God restored and he brought bread back to this place called Bethlehem. There was a family that lived in Bethlehem. Now, if you know about Bethlehem, 1,200 years later, Jesus is going to be born there.
Amen.
And the Bible says that there was a man named Boaz. And Boaz was a rich landowner, and he was from the tribe of Judah. He was from the tribe of Judah, but the Bible says he was an Ephrathite. Which it would make you think it means he was from Ephraim, but that's not what it means. It means that there were certain people that when they lived in Bethlehem, they were called Ephrathites. He was from Judah of Ephrathah. He was a Bethlehemite that was from the tribe of Judah. Why does that matter? Because we were promised that the Messiah would come from Judah. Amen? And Ruth was a Gentile. She was a Moabite woman. And her husband had died. See, when the famine happened, Naomi was her mother-in-law. They went over to Moab and her son married Ruth. And the next thing you know, her two boys died and her husband died. And now Naomi's left all alone. And the other one, Orpah, she refused to go back with Naomi. But Ruth clave to her and said, no, I'm going back and your God's going to be my God. And next thing you know, it's harvest time. And they don't really know what they're going to do because they're about to lose their property. And what Naomi, her mother-in-law, told Ruth to do was this. Boaz was called the kinsman redeemer. The Bible in the Old Testament, the way the King James translators translated it, they called him the kinsman redeemer. What that means is that the next of kin was the only one that could redeem or purchase the property and in a sense purchase a bride. That's really the theme of the story. It's about harvest and about the purchase of a bride. And it's not about just any purchase of a bride, but the purchase of a Gentile bride. Do you understand what I'm saying? Any nation that's not Israel is considered Gentile. What that means is that God from the beginning, though, said that he was going to purchase them all. He was going to marry them all. And the Lord has a plan for each and every one of us, not just the Jewish people. That's where he started, and he desired to use them to tell the rest of the world that he was real. And what Naomi told Ruth was, the man's going to be at the threshing floor tonight.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Now what I need you to see is that it all takes place in Bethlehem. He comes from the tribe of Judah. Jesus comes from the tribe of Judah. Jesus was born in a place called Bethlehem. There's a parable in Matthew 25 that says that a king is preparing a marriage for his son. I'm telling you, God's preparing a marriage. He wants people to marry Jesus. Hallelujah. And he called him the kinsman redeemer, the next of kin. Hebrews chapter 2 says this, that because the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he became the same. What does that mean? He became your kin. He became your brother. He was the eternal word that spoke the world into existence. He tempted and clothed himself in human flesh so that he could be your brother, so that he could be your kinsman, so that he could redeem you through the shedding of his blood. There Ruth met Boaz at the threshing floor that night. And from that point moving forward, Boaz purchased her property. Boaz purchased her as a bride. Amen. I need you to know that at the threshing floor, if you're gonna have a relationship with Jesus, you're going to have to meet him at the threshing floor. Because God is causing the separation to take place. And one of the things that I've told y'all before, and I want to say it again, is this. Is that the word for church in the Greek is this right here. This is another preposition. It means out. This is where we get the word called, and it means called. Okay? And what does that mean? Called out. The word church means the called out ones. That's why the people at the festival might not like the fact that you go up to and you talk to them and they're like, no, dude, I'm good. I believe. But the reality of it is that those that have been called out are not the same. The Lord begins to work in their lives and he changes them. Amen. And if you're going to get married to Jesus, amen, you're going to be a called out one, not a perfect one. Here there was only one perfect one. Amen. I'm saying you're going to let the Lord begin to work in your heart. and in the midst of your life. Amen. That was the first stop I wanted to talk to you about. I want you to realize that there's a story about a marriage of a Gentile bride. Amen. The second stop that I want to tell you about comes out of 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 10. And in 2 Samuel 24, verse 10, really in the whole chapter of 24, let me just, you may remember this story, you may not, but it says that David had a desire to count his army, to count his men. Y'all remember that story? And his general said, "Why do you want to do that? The Lord of hosts, he's the power behind our army." I'm kind of paraphrasing. "For each man that you have, God can make 100 more. Why do you want to count them?" So the idea is, it's not just that David's counting his army. The idea is that David wants to put, he's actually putting faith and trust in the numbers of his army. You understand what I'm saying? In a similar fashion, you and I oftentimes put trust and faith in us getting things accomplished in our lives. Exactly. And us getting free in the midst of our lives. And because of David's choice to put his faith in what it was that he was going to do, or in his army, instead of trusting in God's power to bring victory, a plague came upon the land. God gave David a choice. He said, "You can have famine, I can let your enemy overtake you, or you can let me put a plague in the midst of the land." David said, "Put me in the hands of God, because I don't want to be put in the hands of my enemy." And so a plague came through the land. 70,000 people died. Whenever the plague began to hit Jerusalem, God told the angel to stop. David cried out and wanted to know what to do. God told David, man, this was so good. God told David, "There's a threshing floor. It's called the threshing floor of Arana the Jebusite. You got to go buy that threshing floor." And when he bought that threshing floor, what he did was he built an altar. He built an altar and he offered up a sacrifice. And when he offered up that sacrifice, the plague was stopped. Now, I got to tell you that there's some really interesting information, some really, really rich history about this place, Arana the Jebusite's threshing floor. Because many people believe that it's the same spot that Abraham offered up Isaac on an altar 1,000 years before that. It was on the place called Mount Moriah where God told Abraham, "Take your son, your only son, and offer him upon a mountain that I will show you." And whenever he got ready to thrust the knife in the lad's chest, God, the angel of the Lord, said, "Hold stay, because there was a ram now caught in the thicket." And I know from the scriptures that at that point in time, God spoke to Abraham and said, you're going to offer up your son, but this is a picture that I wanted to show you and the rest of the entirety of the human race. You don't have to do it, because I'm going to do it. I'm going to send my only begotten son upon the earth, and I'm going to offer him as a sacrifice, yes, in place of the sins of humanity. Amen. But not only that, if you move forward from the place of Arana, the Jebusite, and the threshing floor, is the very spot that Solomon built the temple. What's the purpose of the temple? A place where God's presence can dwell. And when you begin to look and put all of those pieces of the puzzle together, you begin to realize that, yes, God at a threshing floor is causing the mixture to be separated. And the way that he's doing it is he's offering up his son as a substitute sacrifice on an altar called the cross. And at that same altar is where the plague is going to be stopped. And not only will the plague be stopped, but it's going to allow man to dwell along with the presence of God. Amen. And that's another thing that happened at another threshing floor. The last third place that I wanted you to see, and I'm actually going to ask Sandy to put this one up on the board, 1 Kings 22:10. And the reason why I wanted her to put this one up on the board was because I almost missed it myself. You can't really see it in the original language. It doesn't really tell it to you too well. And when you start looking it up in the dictionaries, then you can see it. In verse 10, this is what it says. "And the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, sat each on his throne, having put on their robes, in a void place in the entrance of the gate of Samaria, and all the prophets prophesied before them." That word void place right there literally means threshing floor. You remember how I told y'all a threshing floor was a place that had been cleared out? So it's not necessarily threshing time right now, but it's already a cleared out spot. And what's happening is, let me tell you what the context is right here. The king of Israel, you know what his name was? It was Ahab. Y'all remember Ahab? Y'all heard of him before. He was a very, very wicked king of Israel. And the king at the time, Jehoshaphat from Judah, he goes up to Israel in Samaria. Y'all remember the little map that I've drawn for you before so that you can have a little bit of a picture of what's going on? This is during the time frame of the kings. Right? This is the Sea of Galilee, the Dead Sea, the Jordan River. Judah was down here. This is Jerusalem. The southern part was Judah. The middle part was Samaria. And then the upper part was Galilee. All right? And so Samaria was right here in the middle. And if you'll remember, what happened in Samaria under the reign of Jeroboam? You remember he built a false altar here. And he also built one up here in Dan. And he had golden calves, and he told the children of Israel to worship these false gods. And Ahab is the worst of all of them. They're worshiping all kinds of false gods. And but Jehoshaphat, he still has a little bit. You ever been in a part of your Christian walk where you know you're not where you need to be, and you know you're not doing what you're supposed to do, but at the same time, you just feel something in your spirit, the Lord's speaking to you, and he's showing you something's not right. You know what I'm talking about? God's good like that, isn't he? Praise God. We love you, Lord. Thank you for still speaking to us, even whenever we're not right sometimes. Amen? And but Jehoshaphat went up there, and he was going to make an alliance with this wicked king. And they were going to go to war. And Jehoshaphat says, man, I feel like we need to seek the counsel of the Lord from a prophet or something. And yes, man, we got all kind of prophets. Yeah, they had 400 prophets of Baal. Remember, those are the ones that Elijah had the showdown with on Mount Carmel with. That's what they're doing. They're in the midst of this open place, this threshing floor. They're sitting there upon their thrones, and now they have these prophets that come to them and begin to speak to them. Now, what we, if we read the story, get a little bit of an advantage. And the reason we get an advantage is that we get a picture of what's actually taking place in heaven. And what's taking place in heaven is this. God says, who can I send? All of a sudden, a demon spirit shows up. Now, you got to hold on a second here. Now, just slow down a little bit. Let me explain this. A demon spirit shows up and says, I'll do it. And God says, well, how are you going to do it? I will be a lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets, and I will tell them what they want to hear. God said, go ahead. Now, hold on a second, because you're about to get good. And all of a sudden, these prophets, one after another, begin to prophesy. Go down to your enemy. Go up to your enemy. Fight them. God's going to give you the victory. Look at these horns that I've built for you. Horns represent power. Just as these horns can gore a man, God will give you the power, and he will give you the victory. And prophet after prophet after prophet after prophet gave the same message. Jehoshaphat sitting over there squirming on that throne because the Holy Spirit is dealing with his heart and telling him, something's not right with this. So Jehoshaphat says, is there not another prophet of God that we can listen to? And Ahab says, there's this one guy, Micaiah, of the son of Imlah. I can't stand him. He never tells me what I want to hear. Jehoshaphat said, please go get him. So Micaiah starts to tell him the same thing. And I can about imagine this is probably how he does it. Go up to your enemy and bring you, God will give you the victory. And they're like looking at him and they're like, no, they know he's not telling them the truth. And finally he says, oh, you want to know the truth? If you go do that, you're going to be defeated. Is what's going to, because God is not with you. And he says, you see what I'm saying? He never tells me what I want to hear. He never tells, but he's trying to tell you the truth, Ahab, but you refuse to listen. The point that I wanted to make with that is that on this journey of Christianity, as we see this mixture that's there and God's doing this separating, along the way, there's also going to be truth and there's going to be lies. The two of them are coexisting together, and you got to be careful that you don't get yourself connected to false doctrine, because if you do that, it will cause a confusion and it will make it much more difficult for you to be able to determine the truth on how God wants to set you free. Amen. Now, one of the last things I don't want to tell you is really because when I was thinking about that passage of scripture, it reminded me of a New Testament scripture. Maybe you could throw it up there, Sandy. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 11 through 12. Now, some people may, have differing opinions on whether this is if you believe in a mid-trib rapture or a pre-trib rapture, okay? Because it talks about the Antichrist. And it talks about the fact that the Antichrist is going to be able to have lying wonders. He's going to be able to perform miracles that's going to cause great deception in people's minds. But what it said right here in 2 Thessalonians 2 is very similar to what we just saw in the book of Kings. Because what happens is that just as God allowed a lying demon spirit to speak through lying prophets, lies to people, it says in the end days, he's going to allow it to happen again. And I'm going to be honest with you. I believe it's already happening.
Yes.
I believe that the apostasy, if you go back and you read it, it calls it the great falling away, is already taking place.
Yes, yes.
And that there's false doctrine being preached upon the TV, being preached upon the airwaves, being preached in mega churches and churches all over the place, that is not the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ and is leading people astray.
Yes.
And the thing of it is that the people want to hear that. The Bible says that in the end days, that they're going to be people with itchy ears. Y'all heard that in scripture before. The word literally means, give me pleasant words. I want to hear words that are pleasant and what I want to hear. And because of that, they're falling away from the faith.
Yes.
And they're going to heap to themselves piles of preachers. I'll listen to this preacher, and this preacher. But don't send me Micaiah, the son of Imlah, because he never tells me what I want to hear. You understand? And then there's the prophet of God, and then there's lying prophets. And they're like hirelings that Jesus talked about in the book of John. He said they'll never stay and really do the work of the Lord because they're just a hireling and they're going to flee when the wolf comes because they have no vested interest. They don't have a revelation and a heart for God to understand that the people of God are God's people. They're not the preacher's people. And you're not supposed to come up in here just for your own greedy gain. But instead, you're supposed to speak forth the truth of God's word, whether God's people want to hear it that way or not.
Amen.
That's why Jeremiah the prophet said he didn't like the way they were looking at him. But I told you last week, and I'll say it again, he said, I'm going to quit telling them the word of God. I'm tired of the way they look at me. And he said, but whenever I do that, when I try to hold back the word of God, it's like a fire shut up in my bones. And I grow weary when I try to hold it back.
Yeah.
Amen. God's word has to come forth.
Yeah.
Amen. And what I wanted to tell you is in 2 Thessalonians 2, it says right here, for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. What it means, if you go back and you read the passage, it means that he sent truth. God sent truth, but people refused to believe the truth. And so because of that, just as he allowed that lying spirit to speak through Micaiah, he also is going to allow people to be deluded. Because that's what they really wanted. God gave man a free will, and when man takes his free will and chooses instead to hear a lie, God will allow it to take place. You know, I'm about to close, but there was one guy I was talking to on Friday night, and he was pretty smart. And we sat there, and this is another one. I could see it happening in his brain as we were talking. He said, dude, you could talk to me all day long. Man, I'll let you sit here and talk to me. I like talking about this, but I will not believe. And at one point in time, I started talking to him about pyramid structures and ziggurats all over the world, mother-child deities all over the world, flood stories all over the world. And I could see his brain recompute. Sierra told me that the other day. She said, Dad, I was looking at you when somebody was talking, I could see your brain was trying to recompute. Like, you know, like, wrong information, recalibrate. Yeah, that's what he was doing. He was like, But his message was, I could see it in his head. This is true information, recalibrate. And he was trying to recalibrate, but then he shut it down. He stopped it. He said, that makes sense, but I'm not going to believe. I'm not going to believe. Because he had trained his brain to purposely choose, and he says that he blames it on his brain, that he's not going to believe. The truth of the matter is that there are people out there that have processed the information and that they've chosen instead not to believe.
Yes.
There's a separation that's taking place. And that what I ended up telling him, not just talking about that kind of stuff, but this is where it was. He said, you mean to tell me, this is important that you hear this, you mean to tell me that if I live a good life and I'm good to my fellow neighbor and I do as best that I can, better than some Christians, I'm like, hey bro, I'm with you on that. Mm-hmm. Better than some Christians, that I'm not going to be able to go to heaven? And I'm like, well, time out, Hoss. If you could do enough good stuff to get to heaven, then why would Jesus have to hang naked on a cross?
Amen.
The one who never sinned, why would he have to die on a cross to pay the penalty of man's sins if we could just each one of us do our own goodness and get through this thing? And so that's whenever his brain kind of started to recompute a little bit, and he started to think about it. I said, no, the difference between me and you is that I heard the truth. By his grace, through faith, I believed the truth. And you are rejecting the truth. And I said, but what I need you to understand is that the payment's already been paid. As a matter of fact, there's a deposit waiting for you in the bank right now. It's waiting for you, bro. He paid the price for your sin. You're already set free. But you're going to have to get in your car faith, and you're going to have to go over there, and you're going to have to take the deposit for yourself. And if you don't, it's going to be because you chose to reject the truth of the gospel that went forth. Four things that I wanted to leave you with real quick, and it's just kind of like a summary. Number one, like the oxen in the sled separated chaff from grain, God allows trials to reveal chaff in our lives and the wind of the Holy Spirit to take it away. I just want you to know that you can't do it. You need to cry out to the Lord. And if you mean business with God, he will move in your heart and in your life. Amen. And he will set you free. Amen. Number two, like Boaz purchased and married a Gentile bride named Ruth, God purchased humanity with the blood of his son. He's planning to marry a bride, but in order to marry the Lord, you will have to meet him at the threshing floor. You will have to be separated out. That's why the word ecclesia means called out ones. Number three, man can't fix his own problems. Just like David tried to remedy the situation, tried to trust in his own strength, you need to know God has a plan. There's a place with great history. A place where a substitute sacrifice was offered. That was later the threshing floor of Arana, the Jebusite, where another altar was built that stopped the plague. A place where the temple would stand and God's presence would dwell. And this is the plan of God. That right there, we just preached the whole gospel in just that one little place. Amen. Called Arana, the Jebusite's threshing floor. And God's presence would dwell, and this is the plan of God. With the substitute sacrifice of his son and the altar of the cross, God will separate out a people, stop the plague, and bring a harvest home. Last thing, number four. While you're in this Christian journey and walking the path towards separation, you have to remember that there's good seed and bad seed. There's good doctrine and false doctrine. There's truth and lies. It's only the truth of the gospel that says man's first birth in Adam must die with Jesus at the cross. You got to realize that you can't. When you go out there, people will admit, I've committed a crime. Well, I've had some failures. Oh, I got a drinking problem. No, sir. And I don't mean to be rude, because I got the same problem you do, Hoss. You got a sin problem. You were born of your father Adam the first time, and it's a sin problem that's ruling and reigning in your heart. And it's because it's not society that you failed. Oh, we look at the guy that went to jail, and we look down upon him with our crusty little self-righteous nose, and we look down on the guy that went to jail, and we're like, oh yeah, look at you, man. I didn't do what you did, you know. But the reality of it is that the problem isn't that you just offended society. No, the problem is you offended God. You went the opposite way of God, because you might not have went to jail, but God only knows what you did in the dark, in the middle of your, behind your locked door up in your house. And the point is that even though you might not have supposedly committed a crime there, you just didn't get caught for it, you offended God. You sinned against God. I know that that's hard preaching, but it's just real. When we sin against God, God has an answer for sin, and it's Jesus. And we have to come to the recognition of that. It's only the truth of the gospel that says that man's first birth in Adam must die with Jesus at the cross that allows true salvation. Any other messages, lies that tickle the ears of Ahabs around the world and leads to deception and blinded eyes. Lying doctrines will never set the captive free. They promise victory as they turn the lock and throw away the key.